third and run scored. A high-powered offense for the Kentucky Wildcats. Great crowd here at Rhodes. And here is the first pitch from Fouts to Kowalik. Strike one, off and running. Kayla Kowalik, like I said, just one of the most dynamic and versatile players in the entire country. The senior was a second-team All-American last year. Led the SEC in batting average for the entire season. On a 14-game hit streak.
Gray, she is so fun to watch. I feel like anytime you turn on Kentucky softball, all eyes go to her. Because just like you said, she is dynamic. She brings a lot of energy to this team. I mean, she just plays the game so well.
And we had a chance to talk to her in pregame as we were waiting on Coach Lawson to come over, and just one of the most eclectic personalities you'll find, not just in the SEC, but in the country.
Yes, she is. She's very personable, very fun to talk to. Talked about different meals we like to eat. I mean, you know.
Food came up. I'm shocked.
You know, as softball players, we love our snacks.
Outside, 2-2. And Kayla Kowalik has loved facing Alabama in her career, a 361 average. RBI, a triple. Has struck out 7 times, but 13 for 36 all time against the Crimson Tide. Full count. Last year in the Super, went 2 for 5, had a couple walks. She was walked to load the bases in game one of that Super Regional. It ended with the Fouts strikeout. Payoff, got her. Fouts starts it off with a K, one down.
And I think Fouts had a little bit of help there from her catcher, Allie Shipman. See that screwball moving very well on the outside corner, and Allie Shipman able to get around it and get the very nice frame there for the strikeout of Kayla Kowalik.
Montana Fouts, one of the best in the SEC, and K's second in the conference. First pitch is fouled off by Riley Smith, junior out of St. Louis, Missouri. On the SEC all-newcomer team last season and was a thorn in the side for the Crimson Tide. Had the walk-off in game 3 in Lexington after having the game-tying home run in the 7th. Walked it off in the 8th. Sydney, I know we talked about it a little bit with Coach Lawson, but as a pitcher, does the familiarity enter your mind at all, knowing that you're facing a lineup and many players who've seen you a bunch throughout your career?
It does a little bit. I mean, to me, you know, whenever we would play teams several times and, you know, you have the Kayla Kowaliks, the Riley Smiths that keep coming back and who have had success, it all comes into the game planning. So I can imagine that pitching coach Stephanie Van Brickle-Prothro and Montana Fouts went over film this week and different ways to approach the hitters, see what worked last year. And, you know, just like hitters and lineups change every year, pitchers change too. You know, they can develop new pitches. Some things may be spinning a little different. You know, especially it depends on how you age as a pitcher as well. You know, sometimes some pitches just don't feel as good as they used to, and you have to make adjustments based off of that. I don't think Montana Fouts has any of those issues. I'm just speaking from my own experience. But just like they make adjustments, pitchers make adjustments too. So I think it comes down to the game planning and different ways to set up hitters.
1-2 is outside.
But the other side of that coin is, would it be an advantage to the hitters to see the pitchers again? It can also be advantage to the pitchers too, because then again, you can bring out the hitters' weaknesses. And again, you don't have to throw what they were successful on either.
Another full count from Fouts as Smith works it to a 3-2.
It looks like Fouts is losing that rise ball just a little bit high. throughout the zone, starting a little too high and then just continue to move up and out of that zone.
Payoff, back to the circle. Fouts has to hurry. In time, two gone. And that's a big play for Alabama because defense was a problem on Wednesday against Florida State. Three errors, Sydney, against the Seminoles.
Yeah, Wednesday night, not a good night defensively for the Crimson Tide. It was a sold-out crowd. And, you know, Gray, it makes you wonder if, with all the new people of the Crimson Tide, did the crowd have an effect maybe on the mental?
Yeah, perhaps. I mean, it was a rocking house here on Wednesday. Lauren Johnson takes a first pitch strike.
And being that we have another sold out crowd here at the Rhodes House, I think it's something that these players are going to have to get used to.
Well, we talked to Rachel Lawson before the game, and she said she just loves playing here because of the atmosphere and because these fans get so into the game. It's really good for her team to experience that so that they know what that feeling is like going forward in the rest of the season. One fouled off by Johnson, the graduate from Owensboro, Kentucky. She's had a really long, successful career and having a great season for the Wildcats. Seventh in hits, 10th in runs scored. Hitting 438 this year against ranked teams. Just missed, 2-2.
You know me, Gray. Being a former pitcher, I would absolutely want that pitch. Very close and similar to the one that struck out Kayla Kowalik earlier in this inning. I would even beg to differ that that one was a little bit more of a strike.
Johnson fights that one off. Yeah, I know how you pitchers are. You want that strike zone to be as big as possible.
Oh, absolutely. If it was up to me, it would extend way into the other batter's box. Can't believe nobody else thinks that way. I mean, I just don't understand it.
2-2. To third, Prangy in time, 1-2-3 for Alabama. Montana Fouts mows him down in order. Bama. There was a time when we were concerned about rain, but no more here tonight. What a beautiful evening here in Tuscaloosa as we head to the bottom of the first and we take a look at the Kentucky hurler. The freshman Alexia Locatena getting the start tonight, making her first appearance in SEC play, but a player who has a lot of experience on the big stage. So.
Absolutely, she does, Gray. She's played for the Italian national team this summer, has experience in the Olympics, and Coach Rachel Lawson says that Locatena keeps the ball low in the zone, is super competitive, and just absolutely loves the game of softball. So excited to watch her and see what she can bring to this game.
First pitch from Locatena is high to Jenna Johnson in the leadoff spot for an Alabama lineup. Trying to strike early like they did on Wednesday. Allie Shipman right there in the three hole. 28 RBI on the season.
You can hear the Bama faithful already. Not too fond of that strike call.
Johnson out to center, and a nice catch by Spangler, laying out for out number one.
Gray, talk about a full layout from the center fielder Spangler on this play. You can see she goes all out for that ball, and it pays off, keeping Jenna Johnson off the bases. And you see Lockatena very excited, as she should be. I would also like to point out that Spangler is also a pitcher for this Kentucky Wildcat lineup, so respect to all the athletic pitchers out there able to make those places.
You weren't doing that in your college career?
I mean, I was in practice.
The one to Ashley Prangy is high. Prangy, the Ohio State transfer. Senior from Indiana. Has the best batting average on the team against ranked foes. 8 of 24 with 5 RBI. He scored 9 runs. Out to right. Smith on the run. And it drops between Smith and Spangler. Prangy heading for third. One out triple for the Crimson Tide here in the bottom of the first.
Prangy does a great job taking what looks like a changeup up in the zone and just driving it opposite field. Looks like there could have been a little bit of a communication error between Smith and Spangler. Both were going for it, and then all of a sudden kind of hesitated. And Prangy takes advantage, making it all the way to third.
First pitch by Shipman is hit to center. Catch made. Here comes Prangy. Play at the plate is late, and Alabama strikes first on the sack fly. Shipman grabs RBI number 29 on the season, and now Kaylee Tao takes strike one. Graduate out of Madisonville, Kentucky, the three-time All-American. Also preseason All-SEC entering this year. Had a three-run homer on Wednesday against Florida State. To short, Coffles got it in time for out number three, but Alabama.
Coffle doing just a great job putting that inside pitch in play, and Dowling made a good play on it, but it's not quite quick enough, and Coffle reaches.
There is the sophomore from Bremen, Indiana, one of the bright young spots in the SEC last year as a freshman. First pitch is a strike to the Western Kentucky transfer, Kennedy Sullivan. Senior out of Georgetown, Kentucky, had a really good couple years with the Hilltoppers, was Conference USA Tourney MVP in 21, all freshman team selection in 19, on a 7-game hit streak. And Sullivan has been one of their best bats in big games. 4-for-10 against ranked foes, 4 RBI, a couple home runs. There goes Koffel. The throw is late. And Aaron Koffel gets a stolen base. Runner in scoring position immediately here in the second.
Koffel doing a great job getting a good jump off what looks like a changeup by Montana Fouts. He doesn't throw that a lot, so Koffel definitely having some St. Patrick's Day luck being able to get a good jump with that.
Now the 1-2 to Sullivan, off the knob. Sullivan hitting .368 this year with runners in scoring position. On the right side, Woodard on the run makes the catch. One down.
Woodard doing a great job. Gray, I don't know if you could hear it through the headset, but I could hear the communication early. Woodard calling that ball and wasn't quite sure if she was going to make it to it, but has a little bit of speed out there in right field, able to make that grab.
and also important with Jenna Lord over at second base getting the start here today for the Crimson Tide. Kaylee Tao as well on that right side of the infield. First pitch foul from the freshman, Taylor Ebbs. Ebbs, a top 40 recruit coming into this year, according to extra inning softball. Another Wildcat on a hit streak, five games for Ebbs. Quickly 0-2. Does a great job answering. We always track the response stat, which is scoring right after the opponent when given the chance to do so. And Kentucky has answered 19 out of 33 times here this year. Trying to do so after Alabama scored a run in the first. Back to the circle. Two gone, and Tao will keep an eye on Koffel as she gives it back to Fouts. And out comes the head coach for the Wildcats, Rachel Lawson. What a career in Lexington. A World Series appearance, seven trips to Supers, 16th year with Kentucky after spending time at Western Kentucky. Great playing career at UMass, went to the 92 World Series.
Great. I tell you what, I absolutely love Rachel Lawson. She just instills this fire in her players and really just ignites them to compete. And before coming here this weekend and starting, you know, this second season, SEC season, she told her team, hey, you want to be a championship team, then you got to play against the championship caliber teams. And that's their goal this weekend, is to really compete against the Alabama Crimson Tide.
When she is also used to making changes already, a pinch hitter coming in. She told us in pregame that we would see Renee Abernathy at some point in the lower part of the order, senior from Springfield, Illinois. A 400 career hitter against Alabama with three RBI and three home runs. But it was Abernathy who struck out in game one of Supers last year against Fouts. There you see the Super Regional stats, 2-for-6 with one of those three career home runs against the Tide.
Yeah, Gray, I told Coach Lawson to take it easy on me with all of these changes that she likes to make, but obviously me and her were not on the same page whenever we were communicating about that.
That's why we have so many pins and Sharpies up here, just to be safe. Abernathy is hitting .500 this year with runners in scoring position. Koffel's over at third right now. One.
And you see Shipman here with a really good stop, especially with the runner on third base. Super important to keep that ball in front of her.
Low ball four. Runners on the corners for Kentucky here in the second. Chance for Emmy Blaine, the junior from Hopkinsville, Kentucky. Strike one. There you see the psychology major hitting .300 on the year, .417 of the last five games. Looking to get a big time hit to tie up this contest on the top of the second.
Yeah, Gray, both of these teams really attacking early in this game, getting on base. can already tell it's going to be an exciting game. It's only the second inning.
Well, in 2019, Kentucky came here, and all three games were classics. Kentucky won that series 2-1. Popped up. Shipman will try for it just off the glove.
Great effort there by Shipman. Just couldn't quite get there, and looks like she didn't really see it off the bat. And
it does give Blaine another chance. The 1-2. Popped up on the left side. Prangy makes the catch for out number three that has ever existed. Although, City, we can't talk about Mic'd Up Monday without referencing what was shown right there. The Beth Tarina, yes. One of the all-time greats.
Great. That is probably my most favorite of the Mic'd Up Mondays. I mean, you just see the emotion. Her laying down full out on the ground screaming no. And then it works out in the end, so... That's why I love Mic'd Up Mondays. You get to see the personalities of all these coaches. You see sometimes a different side of them. Sometimes it does work out, sometimes it doesn't. But again, I think it's always fun to watch.
And Tim Walton was mic'd up this past Monday. As Coach Murphy looks on to Bailey Dowling, the sophomore. Dowling trying to get it rolling. Has struggled against ranked teams this year. 4-for-24, 4 RBIs, a homer. 7 strikeouts against those ranked foes. There you see La Catena, as we talked about, a member of the Italian national team, pitched at the Olympics in 2020. However, while that stage was big, there were no fans in Tokyo, so this will be the biggest crowd that she has seen while pitching thus far in her young career.
Yeah, great you say that. I wasn't even thinking about that. I mean, that's very true. There were no fans, so this may be a completely new environment for her. So interesting to see if any of the moments playing in these sellout games this weekend or in the future for Kentucky will either amp her up or if it gets to her, but very exciting to watch and see.
And not the only Olympian with the program, Brittany Cervantes, part of the Mexican national team, on staff at Kentucky. Payoff from Dowling to deep short. Koffel is there for out number one.
Yeah, just a slight flex there, having two Olympians as a part of your staff.
One down for Abby Doerr, junior from Eugene, Oregon. Takes ball one. Doerr, another player, trying to get things rolling at the plate a little bit. 0-for-10 in the last 5 games. Does have an RBI in there. Well hit to left. Johnson on the run, makes the catch. 2 gone. Tomorrow's softball matchup is the second game of a big 3-game series between Ole Miss and Mississippi State at News Park. Our coverage begins at 5:30 Eastern, 4:30 Central, right here on the SEC Network and the ESPN app. Game one is already underway, and Starkville, Mississippi State leads that one 4-0 over the Rebels.
Yeah, Gray, those in-state rivalries have a little bit more to them than just your normal SEC series.
And last year in Oxford, Ole Miss swept Mississippi State. As we take a look at Jenna Lord to third. Nice snag by Stoddard. And the ball was jostled out of the glove of Ebbs. Lord will stay at first. Out comes Rachel Lawson.
Gray, that was an interesting play there. A great play by the third baseman, Stoddard. You can see Ebbs at first. That ball, as soon as she's run into there by Lord, it just pops right out of her glove. And I wonder if Rachel Lawson is wanting to look and see if there was actually a catch made so that it could be out. And then the ball flew out. I don't really know.
Well, we are reviewing it. Rachel Lawson will use one of her two coaches' challenges, which is a new rule in the SEC. We've got two for the entire game.
I wonder, too, if even her foot was on the bag or not. Not that that matters. She would have went and made the tag.
There you see the reviewable plays, padded balls, pitched balls, tag plays. I'm sure looking at that as well as perhaps a collision with Lord running into Ebbs right there. A lot that can be taken into account in this play. It is centralized replay, so the umpires are talking to the SEC office in Birmingham right now.
So whenever she made the catch, her foot was on the bag, and then tag applied. Maybe not intentionally, maybe it's just kind of where her glove got caught up, and that's whenever Lord ran into the glove and the ball popped out.
Based on the looks we are seeing, Sydney, I would think this might be reversed. But Rachel Lawson was telling us she was watching the replays from opening weekend and thought that some of the calls that she thought would be made were the opposite of her opinion. So who knows what could happen.
And I'd have to agree. I think that Ebbs made the out, and it was clear that she made the out, and then the ball popped out of her glove.
Well, they'll say the play stands.
There wasn't quite enough evidence to reverse this call. She had full control of it by the time it popped out. That's all I can think of, Gray.
I guess the word indisputable coming to mind there. Not enough evidence to overturn it. So Alabama has a chance with a base runner and two outs. It is ruled an error on Ebbs, so the first error of the ball game by either squad, and that has been an issue for Kentucky here this year. 13 of now their 27 errors this season have come against ranked teams. As we take a look at Savannah Woodard, junior from Warrior, Alabama, SEC all-newcomer selection last season. Had a couple doubles on Wednesday against Florida State. And lifts that to left. Johnson tracks, inning over. Well, Kentucky gets out of it. Alabama still leads it 1-0 heading to... We've played two in Tuscaloosa. Alabama leads it 1-0 over Kentucky here in game one of this three-game series. And we spent a little bit of time in the last inning talking about Olympians. Well, that conversation cannot be finished without discussing the great Kelly Kretschmann. Played at Alabama in 98-01. One of the best to ever do it here in Tuscaloosa and with Team USA, Sydney.
Yes, and sometimes you will hear Coach Patrick Murphy refer to Rhodes Stadium as the house that Kelly Kretschmann built. She really helped get this program off and running.
And she watches as Fouts fires in strike one to Stoddard. And of course, speaking of Team USA, Montana Fouts will be a part of that squad at the World Games this upcoming summer in Birmingham. You see the five current collegiate athletes that are on the U.S. Women's National Team for the World Games. Haley McClenney, Alabama grad, will also be on that squad. But it's really great, Sydney, to see so many current players getting a chance on the national stage.
It really is great. And, I mean, just sitting here in this booth, you know, we are in the house here with so many amazing players. And it's exciting to see the growth that softball has had over the past few years, you know, especially this past year being back in the Olympics. And personal opinion here, but I just really think that it's going to continue to grow and continue to take off.
And still waiting on word for the 2028 Olympics in L.A. We certainly hope softball will be there. Shasee Stoddard, speaking of California, the Anaheim, California native junior who has been hitting it well of late in the last five games, 6 of 14 with 10 RBI. 2-2. Back to Fouts. One away.
Fouts getting a lot of action tonight, not only throwing the ball in the circle, but.
Kowalik out to left. The hit streak will continue. A one-out single for the senior, Kayla Kowalik.
Kowalik doing a great job going down and getting what, again, what looks like a changeup there by Montana Fouts and just poking it over the head of Bailey Dowling. Trying to get a rally started here for her team.
And always a threat to run. 8 of 12, or I should say 9 of 10 in stolen bases this year. She is 12th in the SEC in swipes. To third, Prangy to second. And the lead runner is retired. A big second out here in the third.
It's a great heads-up play there by Prangy, the third baseman for the Crimson Tide, to turn and throw to second base. Again, the speed of Kowalik is no simple feat, so great job of her being quick. It will make that turn play very nicely.
It'll be big for her confidence after a couple errors on Wednesday against Florida State. A couple errors on the scorecard and one mental one as well. Good to see Prangy making some plays here early in the contest. First pitch to Lauren Johnson. Misses for ball one.
Yeah, Gray, you mentioned the mental errors and other errors by Prangy over there on third base. You know that she probably worked very hard on that in practice yesterday. So happy to see that for her, that she's not letting it roll into her next game, but instead making the corrections that she needs to and playing good, clean defense.
The transfer from Ohio State back in 2019 was second team all Big Ten and Big Ten all freshman team. Part of that transfer wave in college softball we've seen the last couple seasons. Johnson chases upstairs, 1-2. Lauren Johnson grounded out back in the first, but she is hitting .477 this season with runners on base. And there is Alabama head coach Patrick Murphy. We'll chat with him going into the next half inning. To second, Lord to first, not in time. Johnson beats it out.
A very well placed slap there by Johnson. She gets around that outside pitch, but the hard dirt of the Alabama Crimson Tide field works in her favor. I don't know, Gray, that play is a little bit closer than I originally thought.
Patrick Murphy not using the challenge. So here's Erin Koffel, one of the best RBI producers in the SEC. She's already got a hit tonight. She entered the evening second in ribbies with those 29. And good speed in Smith at second base. 0-2. Stays alive. Aaron Coffle, second team all SEC last year, came into Kentucky ranked seventh in the extra inning softball 2020 class rankings, one of the highest ranked recruits ever in Wildcat history. To right, Woodard, it drops and gets past her. Smith scores and we're all tied up. And another mistake. Johnson will score. Defensive miscues for the Crimson Tide and Kentucky's got a 2-1 lead.
Yeah, a series of unfortunate events there for the Crimson Tide defense. You can see Woodard coming in. She was coming in hard, couldn't quite make it to it. Goodnight with the good backup. And Prangy with a little bit of the missed throw there to second. And poor umpire gets involved too with that play.
Well, the umpire part of the field of play, and that deflection knocked it away because you could see in the background there, Goodnight was covering. It might have gone straight to her, and that second run might have not crossed, but instead, a crazy play allows two runs to come in. It's an RBI single for Coffle. And then they'll say Johnson scored on the throwing error by Prangy. Two-one Kentucky here in the top of the third. Kennedy Sullivan takes strike one.
Gray, that is one of those plays, too, where I just would love to give a shout-out to the SIDs having to score those.
I'm sure there was lots of discussion over in the main press box to our left. There's Coffle at second. 0-2. Fouts gets the strikeout, and Chipman applies the tag to make sure. But Kentucky takes the lead. Two runs cross on one play. Alabama will try and answer when we come back. Kentucky leads Alabama 2-1 heading to the bottom of the third. Gray Robertson and Sydney Littlejohn Watkins here chatting with Alabama head coach Patrick Murphy. Coach, what adjustments do you want to see from your offense against Lakatena as this game goes forward?
Well, we hit her hard. Last inning, we just hit it right to the left fielder. So hopefully we can find some holes and keep swinging at good pitches.
And Coach Murphy, what can you say about Montana Fouts? She seems to be getting ahead of these Kentucky hitters.
Well, I wondered if that 0-2 was far enough out because she swung the one before and barely touched it, you know, hit it in the dugout. And then the next one seemed like it was just a little bit better instead of being like a 4 inches away from the plate, a little bit farther out. But, hey, Sydney, welcome back to the Rhodes House.
Thank you, Coach.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks, Coach. That's Alabama head coach Patrick Murphy. His team trailing 2-1, and you see the line for Fouts. Three innings. Has given up four hits. One of those two runs was earned. One walk, and I don't want to say just two strikeouts, but through three innings of work, that is a little low from what we're used to seeing from Montana Fouts.
I think that speaks to this Kentucky offense. Again, has been known to be an exciting offense and one that can be volatile.
Well, speaking of excitement, Dallas Goodnight leads things off with a slap single. And Alabama's got speed on the bases here in the bottom of the third.
If you're Alabama, this is exactly what you want. Having a great slap there by Dallas Goodnight. Very perfectly placed. I mean, that's textbook. Again, you got speed on the base paths. No outs.
Dallas Goodnight had entered the Florida State game 2 of 21 against ranked teams, but was 2 for 3 on Wednesday and now 1 for 1 here tonight. As both coaches chat with their teams, Rachel Lawson talking with the Kentucky infield and Patrick Murphy discussing strategy with Goodnight over at first. And the top of the order, Jenna Johnson set to bat. Johnson flew out to center in the first. Fouled off. Here you see Johnson's line. We should also note a part of that conversation was Stephanie Van Brakel Prothrow, who's over at the first base coaching box here tonight and the rest of the weekend with Associate Head Coach Allison Habits back with her family. Coach Habits announcing her father passed away on Wednesday. And obviously, Sydney, a man, Coach Habits' father, Leonard, that you as a former part of the team were around often.
Yes, any member of the Habits family is a very special person to me, and they have a special place in my heart. And Mr. Leonard was always known for wearing the cutest overalls, being one of the best supporters of the Alabama Crimson Tide. And, you know, Coach Allie is known as such a great human being, and she says that she gets all of that from her father. So very sad for the family. But, again, Allie, we're keeping you in our prayers and wishing you and your family the best. I do think it's important to point out, Gray, his absolute favorite play was the squeeze play, and can't help but think that he may have played a part in the perfect squeeze play that Alabama executed Wednesday night against Florida State.
Yeah, that was executed by Jenna Johnson. That was something Patrick Murphy told us about before the game. Said if we're going to have a chance, we're going to call the squeeze, and it worked against the Noles on Wednesday. And like you said, Sydney, obviously all our thoughts with the entire Habits family. Kowalik will track this one. Catch made. Goodnight tags up. The play at second. Got her. A double play. Nicely done by the Kentucky defense.
Kayla Kowalik. Again, just such a tool behind the plate. You see that cannon she has, able to make that throw down with the speed of Dallas Goodnight. I love her reaction. You can see the passion that she has for the game and the excitement, again, that she shares with her team.
Yeah, the throw had to be perfect, and it was, as you see Kowalik sporting that very awesome catcher's helmet. We'll talk about a little bit more later on in the game. Prangy back up the middle, and that'll squirt all the way to the warning track. Prangy backs up her first inning triple with a double here in the third. And I have to say, Sydney, that makes me think about the out to Goodnight, because if she were still on base, we're probably tied.
I would have to agree, Gray. You know, don't know if she was intending to go on that play. Maybe thought Kowalik was in a little bit tougher of a position to make that throw, but. I definitely could have seen maybe a tie ball game at this point.
And Allie Shipman says, hey, I can tie it up too. Senior from Valencia, California, the Tennessee transfer, had a sack fly back in the first. To third, Stoddard. Throw was a little wide. Nice stretch by Ebbs. for out number three. But Kayla Kowalik makes a huge defensive play, Sydney.
Again, Kayla Kowalik, again, just so dynamic, an absolute cannon of a throw there to get the final out of this inning.
Pitch by Ebbs is fouled off for strike one. But as we've talked about, Sydney, again, you know, she did play in the Olympics, but there were no fans there. This is the biggest crowd she's ever seen while pitching. Coach Lawson just mentioned that, and I think overall she's kept the nerves in control.
Absolutely. She's been very poised out on the mound. The crowd doesn't seem to have any effect on her. And that's something, too, as a pitcher, sometimes it can be really hard to cancel out the crowd, all the noise, and, you know, if you have nerves, which she doesn't seem to have any. She's doing a great job, but sometimes if you are nervous, a little anxious, sometimes the crowd and all the noise surrounding can amplify that a little bit, sometimes cause you to overpitch, but she's handling it very well.
And you can see right there on her right arm the Olympic rings. What
again,
a cool experience.
Say another slight flex for the Olympians. I can just imagine, too, how cool of an experience that was, being able to play in the Olympics and then come back and tell all your college teammates about it and your experiences and then continue to make great memories with this new team. And again, too, she's a freshman.
It is amazing to think that Alexia Lacatena has faced Team USA before facing an SEC team in her career.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like if I was her, my confidence would just be through the roof. I'd be like, what SEC team? I pitched against all the world-class teams.
2-2 to Ebbs, swing and a miss, and Fouts has her third strikeout, one gone.
Fouts continuing to do a really good job against these Kentucky hitters, working ahead, and then that pitch, I'll be honest, I couldn't tell if it was a screw or a rise. May have been a little bit of both, the Michelle Smith special, the scries.
Here's Renee Abernathy. Abernathy walked back in the second. Just outside, 1-1. The senior on a 7-game hit streak. We talked about her sparkling career against Alabama in the last 5 games. Entering tonight was 8 for 12 with 9 RBI. Here's the 1-2. Swing and a miss, and Fouts has two Ks in this inning and four on the night. The SEC Gymnastics Championship is tomorrow right here on the SEC Network, and our coverage of the first session begins at 3:30 Eastern, 2:30 Central with Kentucky, Missouri, Arkansas, and Georgia. Then at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, a champion will be crowned in the second session with Florida, LSU, Auburn, and Alabama competing. You can always watch both sessions streaming live on the ESPN app from anywhere.
And Gray, let me tell you, I absolutely love college softball. But if there's something that comes close to that, it would have to be gymnastics. I mean, I believe there is a reason that God made me over 6 foot tall so that it would be really, really hard for me to become a gymnast, because it is so entertaining watching those girls perform and just compete.
What a time in college athletics as you see Emmy Blaine, who fouled out back in the second. We've got softball in conference play, baseball starting conference play, the NCAA men's basketball tournament, although don't talk to these fan bases about that. The women's tournament, so much going on. 0-2 misses, 1-2 to Blaine.
So if you're into sports, you're just living in prime time right now.
Misses 2-2. To third, and it's foul. Battle between Fouts and Emmy Blaine. Got her looking. Montana Fouts strikes out the side. Two swinging, Sydney, and one looking.
And you can see Montana Fouts again just continuing to work ahead of these Kentucky hitters and going to all parts of the zone. Screwball, rise ball. She's got it all with her third strikeout of the inning.
Well, game one has been intriguing between Alabama and Kentucky. The Crimson Tide got on the board first with a sac fly from Allie Shipman that brought in Ashley Prangy. But then Kentucky struck back in the third. Two runs in the frame coming on this play. An RBI single from Aaron Koffel that scored Riley Smith. And then a defensive miscue right there, allowing Lauren Johnson to score. Gave the Wildcats a 2-1 lead. So we go to the bottom of the fourth. That's your score. Alabama with 4-5-6 due up. Tal, Dowling, and Doerr. What catches your eye on that game summary, Sydney?
Oh, man. It's just a lot, Gray. I mean, it's been a great game so far. And I think both of these teams, you can see, they're both hitting the ball hard, putting the ball in play. So the pitchers are really having to work in setting up these hitters. And then again, just an unfortunate error there for Alabama. And honestly, what comes to mind is just, I still feel bad for the first base umpire getting involved on that play. I know that ball hurt whenever it hit him.
And there you see Cameron Ellison watching on as Kaylee Tao bats. 3-1. Tao grounded out back in the first. Tao, the Madisonville, Kentucky native, has in her career been good against the Wildcats, entering the night a 366 hitter. Fouls that off to run the count full.
Gray, I can't help but think, since she is from Kentucky, that this game, again, just means a little bit more to her. Not that she would have any reason to have anything against Kentucky, but, you know, that's your home state, so you always want to do well against the home state teams.
Interesting, Sydney, to see the outfield, especially Abernathy in center and Smith in right, playing essentially half depth on Kaylee Tao. Payoff to third. Stoddard has it. One gone.
I guess where the outfield was didn't really matter for that one. I could think maybe, though, playing half so that way, you know, there's nobody on base. So I would think don't want to miss that little short hop, especially with Lacatina keeping the ball low in the zone.
Here we see Smith, Abernathy out in center after coming into bat for Spangler. And Bailey Dowling takes a first pitch strike. Dowling popped out in the second.
Gray, I know that's not the first changeup we've seen from Lacatina, but that one really caught my attention. Just a beautiful pitch there to start off this at bat against Bailey Dowling.
Dowling sky high to left. Johnson will track and a couple steps in front of the wall. She makes the catch for out number two.
You can see there again, Johnson was very close to the wall on that play. Dowling almost put enough on it. If I'm Lacatina, I'm taking a deep breath after that. Sigh of relief.
Two gone for Abby Doerr. Doerr back up the middle. It gets through. Abby Doerr gets the hit with two outs to put a base runner on in the fourth.
Alabama saying two outs, so what? Abby Doerr doing a great job just driving this ball right back up the middle.
That is Doerr's first hit in the month of March. Her last came on February 27th against Louisiana. Two outs for Jenna Lord. First pitch fouled straight back by the freshman. Lord reached on an error back in the second on that play that we reviewed.
Yeah, Gray, that play sticks out to me too. That was all just weird. Weird things happening
tonight in this game. We're getting used to replay as well, yeah. Nice snag by Kowalik.
Kowalik, an absolute brick wall behind the plate.
Patrick Murphy will bring in a pinch runner as we get a look at Kowalik. Sporting that awesome mask, Sydney, that she showed us in pregame.
Yeah, Gray, she was explaining it to us, and I have a list here that has a few of the details on it. You know, there's the Texas state flag, because she is from Texas, has an American flag to symbolize her being an All-American. Of course, the blue checkerboard on it, supporting Kentucky excellence. And then 99 on there, because that's her number. And then along the chin, I thought this was super cool that she has the lyrics to her walkout song. And I love whenever softball players, really any athlete, are able to bring those custom-made pieces that not only show their personality, but show some things that made them who they are and what's important to them.
And she's got the game to back it up. We saw that get on the pitch from Locatena. Here's the 2-2 to Lord, fouled off. So Alabama did bring in the freshman Jordan Stevens out of Tampa, Florida to run at first.
Great, here we have freshman versus freshman. And I know whenever I was a freshman in these situations, I didn't realize how big that they were. So I wonder if they are feeling the same or if they're letting the weight of the situation kind of sink in a little bit.
Well, this is a big moment for Jenna Lord as well. Usually Megan Bloodworth getting the start at second base, but Coach Murphy said he wanted to switch things up here tonight. Lord can make a statement with a good base hit here. Locatena can make one as well if she gets out of it. Foul again.
Definitely a good battle between the two.
Lord, a shot to center. Abernathy on the run, makes the catch on the warning track. The Kentucky defense again makes a big time play to end the fourth.
Abernathy making a statement with this catch to keep her team in the lead here. You can see Locatena, the emotion. She knows how big this situation was.
Home run record is a very exciting, very fan-friendly type record.
This is a big softball record. It's not just an everyday thing that you break the home run record.
Doing it under pressure is a whole nother level.
I've only dreamed of this before. There's so much that you can do with hard work and dedication. It's just a win for Sooner softball.
Many congratulations to Jocelyn Allo, your new NCAA career home run record holder with 96, hitting that 96th in her home state of Hawaii. Passing Lauren Chamberlain from Oklahoma with her 95. Sydney, you have a little tie-in with Chamberlain's 95th home run.
I do. I proudly wear the badge that I was Lauren Chamberlain's 95th home run. And I'll be honest, to this day, I still do not know how she hit it. It was an off-speed pitch. I remember it like it was yesterday. Off-speed pitch, way too high, way outside an other batter's box. And she hits the left field foul pole. I didn't have a hat at the time, but if I did, I would have just tipped it to her because, I mean, it was just incredible. And, again, Jocelyn Allo, just many congratulations to her. And you can't help but think it was something that was already written since she was able to do it back in her home state in front of her family and friends in Hawaii.
And the Wildcats will see Oklahoma on Tuesday on the SEC Network. What a stretch this is for the Wildcats. Three at Alabama, the Sooners in Lexington on Tuesday, and then a home series against red-hot Auburn the following weekend.
Yeah, if you're Kentucky, this is where the saying, it is a marathon, not a sprint, comes into play. You got to take it one day at a time. If you look too far ahead in your schedule, you may get overwhelmed. You may look over a team that you have no business looking over, and that's whenever they come back and bite you. But, again, a tough schedule this next week for the Kentucky Wildcats. It'll be a good test for them.
They're performing well thus far in Tuscaloosa. The 1-2, though, swung on and missed. Shipman will complete the strikeout for out number one. Well, and if you want more conversation about the great Jocelyn Allo and the home run record, you can check out the 7 Innings podcast. Follow him on Twitter and the gram. A lot to talk about on this week's show with Beth, Michelle, Jen Schroeder, Amanda Scarborough, Caleb Rowe, Jenny Dalton Hill, Madison Shipman. Crazy opening weekend in the SEC. It's Women's History Month, so conversations with Marissa Young and Lisa Fernandez. Another great on there as well. Strike one to Kayla Kowalik. Kowalik? 1-for-2, extended her hit streak to now 15 straight games with a single back in the third.
feel like you could say this with any game. Kayla Kowalik, but have a game. And hit streak continues. Had the great double play behind the plate. Just making great dropping blocks, great stops, being a brick wall.
And she, too, will be a part of the U.S. Women's National Team. That'll be in the Canada Cup, which is June 20th through the 26th in 2022 in Surrey, British Columbia.
And I say again, Gray, we are in the presence of greatness here tonight.
Stadium, but you can feel the tension ratcheting up as Kentucky holds on to this one-run lead. Trying to get more here in the fifth. Full count to Kowalik.
Coach Murphy always preaches, you know, whenever you play at Rhodes Stadium, you want to defend your home turf. And so I know he will probably be preaching that through the next few innings as we close out this game tonight, trying to fire up his team.
Payoff to Kowalik, jam to second, two gone. A lot happening around the SEC tonight. So much action in this conference. LSU and Texas, and Texas has the early lead. I say early, it's about midway through against the Tigers. Arkansas and Tennessee in a battle right now. The Hogs had a three-run homer in the sixth. They lead it 4-3 in Knoxville. And Texas A&M up 2-0 on the Florida Gators in College Station in the bottom of the fifth. We've talked about Mississippi State Ole Miss. That is a 6-4 Bulldogs lead in the top of the fourth.
So, Gray, as we continue to go through this weekend, how many screens do you think we could fit in this booth so that we are able to watch all of them?
Well, including phones, we've got four. Perhaps some friends will gift us a few others. Well, we always say, Sydney, nobody is safe, and it seems especially true this year in the SEC. A lot of unexpected results in week one. Week two off to a really good start. And as you see, Riley Smith, who scored one of Kentucky's two runs back in the third, fouls that off, 1-2.
Okay, I think all of the parity in the SEC has to do with the just elevated levels of competition between teams. I mean, the players are getting better within each team. You don't necessarily have a clear distinction between the top few and the bottom few in the conference. I feel like in the SEC, anybody can win or lose on any given day.
Swing and a miss. Fouts has strikeout number 7. But Kentucky still leads it 2-1. Alabama will try and get the bats rolling when we come back. The Kentucky defense, while yes, they have an error, they've made some spectacular plays. Spangler back in the first. Retired Jenna Johnson on that diving catch. Kayla Kowalik caught a ball in foul ground and then fired to second to double up Dallas Goodnight. And then in the last inning, it was Renee Abernathy in center making the catch to help out her pitcher. And while we did talk about Kentucky having issues with errors against ranked teams, those plays have made a difference here tonight, Sydney.
Well, they absolutely have. I think every single one of those plays have potentially kept a run off the board and allowed Kentucky to continue to have the lead here in this fifth inning.
The defense entered the night 12th in the SEC in fielding percentage, but doing strong things here this evening. Woodard fouls off the 1-0. It's 8-9-1 for the Crimson Tide. Woodard, Goodnight, and Johnson. Woodard lined out to left back in the second. gets a piece. 1-2. The 1-2, Woodard rips it, foul. Woodard entered the night a 250 career hitter against Kentucky. Four of her five hits this season have also come here at home. Check swing, foul. Uh-oh, look out. Stephanie Schoonover, the sophomore, warming up in the bullpen. Head on a swivel over there, Sydney.
You know, Gray, I can't tell you how many times I've been hit by a foul ball in the opposing bullpen or even in my home bullpen.
Sunday afternoon, we'll have the baseball series finale between Texas A&M and number 13 LSU in Baton Rouge. Our coverage begins at 3 Eastern, 2 Central, right here on the SEC Network and the ESPN app. One out for Dallas Goodnight, who singled back in the third. Dallas Goodnight, the very impressive freshman, top five recruit, according to extra inning softball coming into this year. Entered the evening hitting .552 here at home. Goes after that and misses, 1-1.
Gray, I'd just like to point out there another great changeup there by Lockettana.
Slap to third, no play for Stoddard. And Dallas Goodnight is aboard for the second time tonight.
And Gray, I talked about her previous at bat having a textbook slap. And another well-placed one right there. It just died right in front of home plate. You could see Stoddard hoping it would go foul, knowing she didn't exactly have a play on it with the speed of Goodnight. I think she made a smart play there by not wasting the throw.
Johnson ripped to left. Goodnight will stop at second, but Alabama's got two on with one out here in the fifth. First hit of the night for Jenna Johnson. Out comes Rachel Lawson. And it looks like Alexia Lockettana's evening is done. Kentucky will make the pitching change. We'll tell you who it is when we come back. Bama with two on, one out, down a run in the fifth. Alexia Lockettana, starter for Kentucky, goes 4 1/3, 6 hits, 1 run, no walks and no strikeout, responsible for the two runners on base right now for the Crimson Tide. The freshman, I think, really impressive in her first career SEC action, but she gives way for the sophomore, Stephanie Schoonover, out of Dothan, Alabama.
What we're gonna see with Schoonovers, she has a really good rise ball, likes to stay more up in the zone, so very strategic by Coach Rachel Lawson to go from Lockettana, who likes to stay lower in the zone, to Schoonover, who's more up in the zone and able to blend her rise ball with her other pitches.
Well, she hits Prangy on the first pitch. Base is loaded with one out as Schoonover just lets that one slip.
First pitch there, looks like she may have just gotten caught up behind her back hip there.
And if you're Alabama, who better to have at the plate than Allie Shipman, as Rachel Lawson comes out to chat with her infield. Allie Shipman tonight is 0-for-1, had a sac fly RBI in the first. But one of the things that has made Shipman so effective, not just the RBI, but her impressive statistics in this ballpark, including from her time at Tennessee. Allie Shipman is hitting .457, 21 of 46 at Rhodes, with now, and that was entering the night, with now including the sac fly, 21 RBI.
And Gray, she's an upperclassman. She's had experience in these situations. Even whenever she was at Tennessee, she was one of their go-to hitters. So very important for her to not let this moment get too big to see what she can do for her team.
First pitch through. Goodnight scores. Here comes Johnson. Alabama takes the lead back as Allie Shipman delivers again.
And have a night, Allie Shipman just cranking out the RBIs. Again, not doing too much here, just getting that inside pitch, turning on it, putting it in play. Just placed well enough between short and third, able to score two runs for the Alabama Crimson Tide to give them the lead now in this game.
And two in scoring position for Tao. First pitch outside to Kaylee Tao, who has grounded out twice here in this game. And you see Tao, 403, her OBP, hitting .250 this season with runners in scoring position. 2-0. And now you have to think about the nerves for the Kentucky pitching staff. This is a staff that entering the evening as a whole had thrown 14 and a third career innings against top 10 teams. Pressure moment for Schoonover. Tao up the middle. Prangy scores. Shipman rounds third, play at the plate. Kowalik tagged her out. The Kentucky defense again minimizes the damage, but Alabama's lead is 4-2.
And a great tag placed there by Kaylee Kowalik to prevent another run from coming across for the Alabama Crimson Tide. And Tao doing a great job just driving that ball back up the middle. And, I mean, you can't blame Coach Patrick Murphy for sending Shipman. I mean, the throw had to be perfect, and it was.
And now is Kentucky making another change here in this fifth inning. Is over at first, and the Wildcats will bring in another pitcher. And Kentucky will go with the freshman, Izzy Harrison.
What we'll see here with Harrison, Coach Rachel Lawson said that she is the best spinner on the team, so definitely going to move the ball through the zone. Has good late break. Going to try to keep these Alabama hitters off balance.
So a big moment in this ball game. Alabama has scored three runs here in the fifth, and the Tide leads it 4-2. As we welcome you back to the booth, Gray Robertson alongside my All-American partner, Sydney Littlejohn Watkins. Alabama had one run through the first four innings. They had a bunch of hits, but couldn't quite hit the timely one. Now the Crimson Tide is starting to string things together.
Right, and talking to Coach Patrick Murphy earlier this week, and he talked about one of the things that they're focusing on as an offense is hitting the ball hard. Doesn't matter where it goes necessarily, but as long as you're putting it in play, hitting the ball hard, good things are going to happen. And I think we've seen the results of that here for the Crimson Tide.
And now a pressure situation for another Wildcat pitcher, the freshman Izzy Harrison, with Bailey Dowling at the plate. Two outs here in this frame. And Dowling just missed. Dowling is 0 for 2, popped out in the second, flew out in the fourth.
Gray, I think that, you know, as a pitcher looking at Bailey Dowling, she may be one of those hitters you look at and you see that she's 0-2. And instead of thinking, oh, we've got her number, maybe, oh no, she's closer to her next hit. I mean, you always have to be careful with a hitter like Bailey Dowling. She just has so much power in her swing.
Alabama played Kentucky 6 times last year, but Dowling never had a chance to face the Wildcats. Suffered that knee injury against Tennessee the second weekend of conference play last year. Dowling misses the rise again, 1-2. Now they just gets a piece.
You can see those foul balls, they are going straight back, meaning that Dowling is right on time with what Harrison is throwing. So if I'm Harrison here with 2 strikes on Dowling, I'm going to stay maybe close to the zone, but not too close.
Swing and a miss. Big time strikeout by the freshman, Izzy Harrison. But Allie Shipman, the senior, has the big 2 RBI double to give Alabama the lead.
And you can see Allie Shipman just putting the team on her back, scoring more RBIs for the night to give Alabama the lead.
Well, what a game one. We've still got 2 more this weekend. Alabama leads at 4-2 against Kentucky, heading to the sixth. Wildcats off 3-4-5 due up, facing Montana Fouts. You see the line right there. Alabama, however, had issues on Wednesday against Florida State, giving up 5 runs in the 6th and 7th innings. So it'll be on Fouts to try and keep this lead against the dangerous Kentucky offense.
Yeah, if you're Montana Fouts right now, you're thinking about just continuing to go right at these Kentucky hitters, getting ahead in the counts, and again, just shutting the door. Your team has given you some run support, so try to keep that margin of error very small.
Look out. Hard foul towards the Alabama dugout by Lauren Johnson. Now, that being said, this is a good part of the order for Kentucky. Johnson, 1 for 2, singled in the third. On deck is Aaron Koffel, who's 2 for 2 on the night. Check swing foul.
And Coach Murphy mentioned earlier in our chat with him that he's wanting these 0-2 pitches to be close, but not too close. And I think as a pitcher, you can definitely float a very fine line working in these counts. And I'm sure Fouts is mindful of that coming through the heart of this Kentucky lineup.
That's low, 1-2. Now, that was pitch 92 for Montana Fouts, Sydney, here in the sixth. Is that a concern at all, considering how many times we've seen Fouts throw in the last couple weeks?
You know, really, I don't think so, because Montana Fouts is known as a strikeout pitcher, and even though she may not have her ungodly amount of strikeouts tonight, she still has a decent amount. And whenever you see those types of pitchers, they typically have a higher pitch count. Whereas typically the more spinny and you hear pitch to contact hitters, you may be starting to worry about that. But I think with her, again, if you see a game where she's 120, 130 pitches, it's just another day.
It's lifted to left and heading out of play.
And by the way, Johnson was running after that. Thought there may have been a chance for a grab there out in left field.
You see Jenna Johnson out in left for the Crimson Tide. 2-2 from Fouts. Johnson again stays alive. Good at bat from the graduate, Lauren Johnson. Entered the night a career 293 hitter against Alabama. Owensboro, Kentucky native, trying to start things off in the sixth. Again, foul. To first, and Tao will step on the bag for out number one.
And a big out there for Montana Fouts. Johnson was not giving up and fouling off pitch after pitch after pitch.
So Johnson retired, and now the cleanup hitter, Aaron Koffel, who has had a really strong evening. Couple singles and an RBI back in the third.
And Gray, again, speaking to that, how big that out was of Johnson. I don't know about you, but I would much rather pitch to Aaron Koffel with one out and no runners on base than no outs and a runner on first base.
You couldn't agree more. She was already second in the SEC in RBI and added another back in that third inning. Straight up in the sky. Dowling makes the catch. Two gone.
And Gray, maybe this is just my PTSD coming out, but nothing strikes fear into me more than those super high pop-ups. I mean, as a pitcher, not only whenever they're hit to the pitchers, but whenever they're so high like that, sometimes, especially these night games, they get lost in the lights, and those are very hard to catch.
Dowling did handle it, and now Sullivan gets a chance. 0-1 to the former Western Kentucky Hilltopper, who is 0-for-2. Struck out back in the third. And now out comes Rachel Lawson to chat with Sullivan. That was pitch 100 for Montana Fouts. Her season high this year is 113 against Southeastern Louisiana back on February 25th.
And again, Montana Fouts is a pitcher that even in her bullpens during the week, she does like to throw a lot. And so she, you know that she's very conditioned for games like this where she's going to get over 100 pitches. And I can't help but think back to, you know, whenever I was playing, Alexis Osorio would have pitch counts up in the 130s, even occasional 140s. And again, it was just another day in the office for her where if I hit 100 pitches, I could hardly get out of bed the next day.
You're
I needed
the
all
ice
the ice bags, yes.
Right on the inside corner for strike two.
Gray, it may just be me, but I feel like Montana Fouts is another one of those pitchers that the higher the pitch count and the later in the game, it just seems like she gets better as she goes.
Swing and a miss. Shipman completes the process. Fouts gets strikeout number 8. Alabama's ace mowing him down. Kentucky will come out and try and keep the tide at 4 runs when we return. A back-and-forth battle here in Tuscaloosa. Alabama led it 1-0, but in the third, Aaron Koffel had an RBI single. One run came across, and then there was the error that allowed the second to come home. Kentucky led it 2-1, and that lead held until the fifth inning, where Alabama strung some things together. Allie Shipman, a two RBI double through the left side. That scored a couple, and then Kaylee Tao right after with an RBI single back up the middle. So Alabama leads it 4-2. It could have been more if not for that great fielding play by Kowalik on the throw from Abernathy. And now Izzy Harrison back out to work. Again, 6-7-8 for the Crimson Tide.
Yeah, Gray, just your casual Friday night here in the SEC. Not too much going on.
A reminder that we have two more games between these teams the rest of the weekend, and if they're anything like game one, buckle up, folks.
I'm sure a treat it will be watching these two teams compete over the weekend.
And we should note all three games are sold out here in Tuscaloosa. 2-0 to Door, and therefore a strike. And yes, so much going on in the SEC, we thought we'd update you. Arkansas takes game one over Tennessee, 4-3. A&M still leading Florida, 2-1 in the bottom of the sixth. Then Texas, not SEC yet, but a big non-conference series. Longhorns lead LSU, 3-0. Door pops it up. Stoddard makes the catch, one down. Should also note, chaos in Starkville. In the bottom of the fifth, Ole Miss leads Mississippi State 8-7.
Again, I'm going to say it again, Gray. Those in-state rivalries, they are something different.
Jenna Lord is 0-2, reached on an error in the second and hit a shot in the fourth that was reeled in by Abernathy on the warning track. In the dirt, 1-1. Izzy Harrison, the freshman, the third pitcher for Kentucky here in this ballgame. Number 36 ranked recruit, according to Extra Innings Softball, entering this 2022 season. Lord to right, and Jenna Lord reaches with a one-out single. Well, we mentioned Ole Miss Mississippi State. Tomorrow's softball matchup is the second game of that big three-game series between the Rebels and the Bulldogs at News Park. Our coverage begins at 5:30 Eastern, 4:30 Central, right here on the SEC Network and the ESPN app. Kentucky fans watching on, hoping that Izzy Harrison can keep Alabama at the four runs. Savannah Woodard is 0-2 and takes strike one.
I just want to say here, Gray, Izzy Harrison has done a great job of throwing first pitch strikes and working to get ahead of these Alabama hitters.
Came in and got the strikeout in the fifth. Woodard to center. Backing up is the new center fielder, Vanessa Nesby, and she makes the catch for out number two. There you see the new Kentucky defense. Nesby, as mentioned, out there in center. Johnson and Smith still in the outfield alongside. Stoddard, Koffel, Blaine, Ebbs on the infield with Kowalik catching. And that infield will have to have their eyes open and be really ready with Dallas Goodnight stepping in. Goodnight is 2-for-2 with a couple singles.
Great. I was going to say, whoever Kentucky seems to put in center field, no matter who it is, seems to be making good plays. So kudos to this Kentucky defense.
Yeah, Nesby is the third center fielder. It started with Spangler, then Abernathy made some great catches and throws, and now Nesby. Two.
You can see that spin there by Izzy Harrison on the rise ball. How it just jumps there at the end. Again, Coach Rachel Lawson talked about the good late break that she has, and that was a great example of it right there.
Yeah, Coach Lawson referred to Harrison's pitches as lively. Here's the 0-2 to Goodnight. Slap to third. Stoddard fires it to first to retire the side. So Alabama can't add insurance. Last chance for Kentucky as we head to the seventh. Alabama leading it 4-2. Heading to the seventh, Alabama leading it 4-2. And Montana Fouts has been doing Montana Fouts things tonight, Sydney. 8 Ks.
You're absolutely right, Graham. We've seen her be very dynamic tonight, throwing several different pitches, utilizing her rise ball, her drop ball, and you see her screwball there just falling off the edge of the plate, and again with the drop. I'd say she's found a rhythm.
Fouts entered with a career 3-2 record against Kentucky. It has been really solid and now faces 6-7-8 for the Wildcats. Her team up by 2 in the seventh. And Ebbs sends it to second, Lord to first, for a huge first out.
And Jenna Lord, the freshman, stepping up. Again, this is a really hard play to make. It deflects off of Fouts' glove. You can see the excitement there by Lord, knowing how big that out was. The first out of the seventh inning. Never an easy one to get.
Jenna Lord making her fifth start this year for the Crimson Tide. Makes that play in the seventh as Renee Abernathy takes ball one. Abernathy is 0-for-1. Walked in the second, struck out in the fourth, but does have a history of seventh inning heroics against the Crimson Tide. She had one of the two seventh inning home runs in game three last year.
I'm sure Fouts has that memory in the back of her mind, especially I'm sure as she was watching film this week. They probably watched their games from last year.
That's low, 2-1. So glad you're with us here for game one of this three-game series. Gray Robertson alongside my All-American partner, Sydney Littlejohn Watkins. Thousands on hand here in Tuscaloosa for the Alabama SEC home opener, the SEC opener for the Wildcats. It's been a great ball game. 2-2.
It really has, Graham. I mean, we have seen a lot of things here tonight, and it's only game one. So who knows what's going to come of game two and game three, but I'm looking forward to it.
Abernathy stays alive. Full count. Nice at bat from Abernathy to work into a 3-2.
And also Montana Fouts keeping those pitches close. I think as we've seen, the later this game goes on, her misses are getting smaller and smaller.
Payoff. Did she go? Yes, she did. Fouts has her ninth strikeout. Two gone. And Rachel Lawson is not thrilled at all about that call from Chad Steers behind the plate. Rachel Lawson wanted Steers to check with Chris Neighbors over at third base and not make the call himself. And the Kentucky head coach very upset after that last play.
I think it's understandable. I mean, Fouts doing a great job keeping the pitch close, but I'm going to get another look at it here, but I'm not sure Abernathy went on it. I'll see from this angle. Because she did come around pretty far there, so I think it stands as a good call, but.
So that means two outs with Emmy Blaine at the plate. Blaine is 0 for 2. Fouled out in the second, struck out looking in the fourth.
And Gray, you never know. Coach Rachel Lawson may have been trying to ignite a fire within her team.
Well, right now the fire is coming from Fouts' pitches as the crowd rises with the 0-2 count. Blaine swings and misses. Montana Fouts strikes her out. Her 10th of the night. And Alabama wins it 4-2 to take game one.